in hierdie republiek van ons. Klou ons nachts aan mekaar vas en hou elke droom by die brug aan die hand en stap saam met die nou pad na die blou lug en sing die stilgesang van wintervoels weg. In hierdie republiek van ons, met die donker hart en swaar gewonde geskiedenis en bloedspoor deur die wattelwoud en pyl wat ratel deur die longe en die honde onder in die kloof wat spoor kry en vat en nes uit mekaar pluk en vis, spyker en hamer vind die hand vanself van die volk. In hierdie republiek van ons dryf die busse en die karre vol kinders onder water en waai die blaaie van die boeke verdoof deur die gange van die skole waar die woorde op swartborde staan en stol. In hierdie republiek van ons rol die tolbos deur die dorp met 'n naalstring agterna en tarntale skreeu en skrou, hou die dag terug, hou die haan plat, hou die stom stil, dek die storm op die tafel, onderhuids of boop beens in die vleis en spier en siel, van die elkeen hier verneel, van die almal hier vermal, van die mal en die gek en die dood normaal. In hierdie republiek van ons is die steen des aanstoot steeds stadig aan die blom in die ploeg van die land om die drom waar die hande die vuurse verbande afskil en nader hert vreet en eet ieder en elk sy broer. In hierdie republiek van ons is die laaste kans die stadig dans deur die verkeerssirkel vleg van die sterre en van die maan met 'n hond onder die arm deur die sneulende boorde van die selfmoorde en die ander moorde en die moorde wat nie eens bedoel was te moor nie. In hierdie republiek van ons, die sagte glimlag van die laaste vrou in die tent van lig waaruit die poel 'n otter snoet en duik en wegdrup en wink en weeg en wip en wip en weg. Wink en wip en weeg en wip en weg. Die snoet van die otter wink en wip en wegduik in hierdie republiek van ons en hierdie republiek. I roll away from the sea and the smell of the Cape as the tide at the command of a moon yet to be named pulls me up the N1, past sleeping suburbs and early risers, headlights lashing yellow snakes along the wet road, and I'm in a dusty dream, kicking my pirogue away from the quay at Mopti in Mali, on the colourful, warm, muddy banks of the Niger River, and I turn it downstream through the smoky Saharan sands towards Timbuktu, with my lone passenger, a goat, looking at me with coin slot black pupils floating in patient yellow orbs. Tonight we shall read the scrolls together and the stars. Sleepwalking, I fill up and buy coffee at the engine winelands where I wander the forecourt like everyone else just a hungry mouth atop time-fermented organs, watching the low clouds slink away as the sun tries to rise behind the mountains to the east. I remember, Marley, it was a long time ago, but I remember handprints on rock walls and the damp darkness inside the Jenne Mud Mosque, and the meal we ate with our hands on the dune. One journey is like the next in the way they loosen us from our skins. Maybe instantaneously, the second you step off the plane, as if you're the meat of an avocado scooped from its previously known home, or slowly, like an orange being squeezed dry until only a semblance of the outside remains, while the inside is leaked out of your mouth and nose and ears and eyes, and you evaporate into, for example, the oven-hot Wolof-speaking landscape where men, women, children, sheep, camels, and Land Cruisers roam. And within all this, that Mali, this South Africa, all of the continent and the globe of the earth which was blown from it by a nameless glassblower billions of time ago. I am alone, entering the suffocating Huguenot tunnel where I hold my breath for long minutes. I am in a James Bond film and I must make it through this underwater tunnel, and on the other side my PPK must still fire, and then I must duck and dodge a bullet and roll away. But as the sun hits the front window from a higher angle, there's none of that. No one-eyed, golden-handed villain, only the tall, skews, skyscraper mountains, and a change in weather, and baboons picking up roadside bits, ticks off the land, tearing along the dotted lines, a stream topped with hundreds of white-sheeted unmade beds, flapping along happily under which trout dart from one wet shadow to the next. De Tweeskloof. Because I am alone, my face is not mine. No one who sees it knows it, and I am as good as a spy. Embedded for decades here in the Platteland, my stories unfolding on the brittle fish moth traveled pages, as the husband of many wives, the father of many children, the owner of many sins, a man who mows the lawn, one that spits and sleeps in rags under bridges, another whose chin is smooth and eau de cologne. I am air-conditioned, platinum-carded and manicured, but also dirty, diesel-coated and rolled in sand. I am the robber that stole the grapes, and the farmer who stole the land, and the burner of tires, and the tapper of rubber. I am Belgian and with a whip. I am the teeth sunk into the rubber tree in the Congo, into the rare earth pit held open by the invisible surgical tongs of the AK-47s in the Chinese and Russian and American and Australian and French-sponsored container office blocks, beyond the uncoiled barbed wire of the cozy compound where the Wi-Fi helps me to pretend that I'm elsewhere. A friendly neighbor, the life of the party, donating money to the poor. In the mirror, my eyes bounce into the blind spots of the car, and on the landscape on all sides, flickering its pixels at my brain, its rocks and its trees, its grass and lichen, houses and roofs, street lamps, cat's eyes, bridges and pylons, signs and poles, fences and sheds, smoke and dagger. And the second is over, and my eyes are back on the road, back on autopilot, back to peripheral vision with my hands here, the vital signs of the car all where they should be. The radio station breaking up and then hissing like water on a hot stove plate as I shimmy into the poort past Worcester. Here is a siding called the Vet. There I have bought boxes of peaches. Through the narrow high cleft like the sight of a rifle through which I'm shot into the hard lines of the Hicks River, past the Durrans, up the pass and into the place where the land swirls between 1 foot in Fynbos, one in Grape Farm, another Fold Mountain, and early onset Guru Kopis, a glance at the Tankwa through a certain gap to the left, onion farms, solar mosaics, the Donkies Rivier, the Toes River, Mikey's Fontaine, Bulower, and then Langsburg, where I observe the speed limit dropping from 120 to 100 to 80 to 60 to a just in case 40. Through town past that new chicken place on the left, and then I hold my breath again as the car goes underwater, crossing the Buffalo Rivier under the 1981 floodline where, should you stop here at night and unimagine all the air brakes and the hellos of prostitutes and the lingering smell of boerewors and petrol and tar dust, you'll feel the mud-wrenched tug of the flood water and the debris and the bodies it carried through here, caulking by the bridge, pulling the walls of mud-blasted houses along, and dogs and donkeys and goats and sheep and cattle and dominies and farmers and children and visitors and neighbors, some swallowed all the way down to the silt of the Floriskraal Dam to become fossils, a couple of layers up from the Triassic era, when more suitably adapted marsh creatures inhabited the shores of the great inland lake of the Karoo, sheep-sized parrot-beaked tortoises, warthogs with scales, leguans, both docile and angry at the rock they had been allocated. Ver op die droomsee ontmoet ons in die golwe met 'n bak vars gesnyde mango en bokkoms en melk lê onder 'n laken tot die wind bedaar, die blaaie en blaai, die boeke en lees, die verte nader met ons harte op die dek waar die meeuwe daaraan lek en die boegte fynkies knaaf in die wier en mis en nag, wyl ons kersa aansteek en dan met die hoofgemaal begin en die fosfor en die sterre uit die ruimte en uit die spieël oproep en ratel, klingel en klatel, visweb uitsuig en komeetstert streel, kie, kop en kosmos kleinte, oeratoom en ou peperboom, die speld in die water en die blom. En die blom in die berg. Oor atoom en die blom en die berg. Now the car has settled in and has taken over the controls, and I sit back and ease along between the yellow and the dotted line. The land stretching like wings on either side of the road, lifting up at the tips, the primaries, where the flukta rolls out to become mountain range and wisp of cloud to the south, where cool ocean air dares to show its face. But not to the north, for beyond that mountain lies more desert and more crows and more prickly pear overgrown sidings and name boards to towns and farms riddled with rust-eyed bullet holes through which the wind sometimes sings to an audience of none, the song of the land touched by humans, once by stone, once by iron, in Netsuachalatstan. Thank you. net soos die hare op my arm regop staan. Die son en die maan, die groot verstaan, die water uit die poel opgedrink, die voel met die takkering kink, die duiker in die kloof verdwyn, die ou mense in die stede aan te kwyn, slaan die weerlig, die veld aan die brand en brand die berge, die bome tot sand, sodat die verlede se hande oopvou, die son en die maan, die groot onthou, die son en die maan, die groot onthou. Tot die beker aan een moe mond, die soldaat se bebloede wond, die graf in die grond, die reghoek, die oomte vars gebakte koek, die kombuis is waar, die mense huil, die kombuis is waar, die mense huil, terwijl die bende, terwijl die bende, buiten. Hier is die hart vandaan, hier is die groot verstaan, die son en die maan, die groot onthou, tot die beker, aan een moe mond, die soldaat se bebloede wond, die graf in die grond, reghoek uit die oond, een vars gebakte koek, die kombuis is waar die mens is skuil, die kombuis is waar. Die mens is skuil, terwijl die wind buiten huil. Hier is die hart vandaan, hier is die groot verstaan. Die kombuis is waar die mens is skuil, terwijl die wind buiten huil en huil. Kombuis is waar die mense schuil. Hier is die hart vandaan, hier is die groot verstaan. Die groot verstaan. And so I saw on the thermals, the car as the roving eyes of the raptor across the land, the shifting thorns, the gravel upon which sheep subsides, single-story white-walled zinc-roofed buildings, some houses, some sheds, some tiny rooms in which generators used to thrum before Eskom came, the old people still hear them at night. And now also, besides windmills, the only other double-story structures like cell phone towers, telecom towers, Eskom pylons walking the land like a chain gang of robots confirming our reliance on magic, channeled from some other place, far from here to where we move, GPS triangulated over the known map of our own making, visible to aeroplanes above, satellites beyond, and possibly the prying eyes of another civilization eagerly awaiting our demise. At Leochamka, the sun belts down from above and from behind and from the sides and from straight ahead and from below, where the tar is hot like the Danakil Depression. Everything is hot, the train tracks, the coins in the till at the Ultra City, the corrugated iron roofs, the eyes of a pale chanting gossel glow like dots of coal, the cheeks of hitchhikers hoping on a miracle emit a shimmer of heat so strong it feels like a train of trucks shuddering past. The road, the heat, the landscape, it is relentless. There is no respite. I am being swallowed by a boiling python. And then I enter Beaufort West. Or is this Baghdad? Zombies drop their flattened cardboard box shields and charge as I slow down to stop at a robot. So I put my foot down, swerve to dodge their flailing arms and Molotov cocktails thrown half-heartedly, lethargically, hanging in the air like blurry, badly built suns. But then up ahead, a trio of buckies with guns. I believe they call them technicals in Somalia. Mounted on the back of pier, and I'm trying to change the channel, but I'm stuck on CNN or Al Jazeera, or is it a channel showing Mad Max or Starship Troopers or District 9? It's all of them at once. and a mortar misses me narrowly as I pull into the parking lot at the steers, and as I jump from the car and run to the door of the shop, the cement bricks behind me are bit into by rat-tat-tat-tat-tat-tat machine gun bullets from a ragtag platoon forted in behind the bins at the western end of the forecourt. But the automatic doors swallow me and I'm safe. And in here the aircon half works and the fridges are half full of half-cold Cokes and Energades, and I take a nachi one and I start drinking it while I order a burger and a medium chips. Five minutes later, I leave the shop, and the forecourt seems clear, except for a small man asking me for money, and a boy lying on his stomach and face by the side of the building, sleeping, or praying, or crying, and I'm in the car, and I reverse and I join the main street traffic, up past the church with its white epaulettes, and then I slingshot around the circle at the northern end of Beaufort West, and I'm back on the N1. The country of our skulls, the rearview mirror soon showing the fading horsemen of the Janja weed, dropping back like tired ghosts, saving their steeds for another day and another less watchful man. There's a turnoff to a place called Nelspoort, and I take it. Because I know, though the town is now but forgotten except to train drivers who still pass through here, because a train track cannot be picked up and moved with ease, so their choice in the matter is small, and the people who call it home who have no choice but to know it too, and the hard way, the way through the bottom of a bottle of beer or cheap wine or vodka or brandy or rum. But there was a time when Nelspoort was significant, when the only people who lived here for the other inhabitants were animals, dussies and mongooses, lions and springbok, leguans and adders, rain frogs and pipits, hartebeest and martial eagles would come from far away, they would walk from far away. To come here specifically, you could say in a way it was a pilgrimage, though the concept would have made no sense to them, for their god wasn't the god in the way we know gods to be today, and in fact they didn't worship a god, but in a way of seeing now, because they have to see from where we are now, because we cannot see the way they saw at all anymore, which is the biggest sadness of them all. They were all gods, and everything they touched were gods. What they ate were made of the fibers and sinews and cells of gods, and when they looked out across the land, all they saw were gods. The smallest grains of sand were gods, the scraggiest of bushes were gods, thorns were gods, eland were gods, a lone cloud was a god, a tear was a god. And so, when they came here as pilgrims, they didn't come to worship at the feet of a visiting distant god, but they came to celebrate their own existence as gods in a country made for gods, not by gods but made by time and the deft and accidental twists and aerodynamic nudges of evolution and chance, of the dice being shaken and rolled out across the land to bounce off the kopjes and along the slight indentations of the karoo to come to rest here, at this place we now call Nelspoort, but which they certainly called something else, something that might have sounded like many raindrops falling on animal tracks in a thick path of dust, or like the sound your teeth makes when you bite into a handful of spatworm leaves, or maybe they called this place the name they had for the smell of the liver, freshly cut from the carcass of a blessbok, now held aloft in your hand and about to be bitten into. When those people came to Nelspoort, they brought with them their favorite memories, which they proceeded to turn into what we call art, but which they didn't call art because art was unnecessary then, and they took those memories from their minds and their tongues and their eyes and carefully chiseled them into the charred black outer layer of the dolerite boulders that litter the kopjes and the hillside around Nelspoort. In that way, in our way of seeing, the seasonal gathering at Nelspoort was a kind of Venice Biennale, where around every corner you could see creation at work, and so the shiny, almost oily boulders would reveal the giant buffaloes that once roamed here, their horns so wide they would almost not fit on the rock itself, all mysterious centipedes a fat balloon like Ilan, or elephant shrews carved out to look like humans in disguise, and the humans themselves, some lone figures carrying bows, others huddled together making a plan, some in formation doing a dance, while their shaman spoke his heart out of his mouth in little slices of blood, so that the gods he or she knew to be the very ants and the flies and antelope and predators of the land could understand him or her better. I drive through Nelspruit and park the car by the roadside about a kilometer beyond the last house. There's a small gate in the fence here, and I walk through it and wait for my eyes to pick out the faint path between the rocks and the shrubs, and then I follow it to the back of a clutter of rocks. I climb up to the top of these rocks and I sit there. I'm now at the center of the universe. And in front of me lies a gong rock. You can't see it if you don't know what to look for, but I've been here before and someone showed me. I pick up a small rock that fits neatly in my hand. Then I strike the gong rock in one of the faint indentations left there by the people who left this place 100, 200, 400 years ago to never return. The rock rings with a clear tone, and the felt around me goes silent. I strike another indent on the flat gong rock, which is at the height of a keyboard in front of me, and again I can feel how everything around me moves closer, paying closer attention. A rock pigeon has diverted course to land 10 meters from me and now cocks its red-ringed eye at me, considering me as an alien maybe, or a lost man from a lost time. Around my feet lizards gather and the curious triangles of dusty faces appear. At the crest of the ridge to my right, the figures of baboons stand up and then they settle down with their elbows on their knees to listen as I play the gong rock. From where I sit and play, a vista stretches to the horizon. If it is the only thing I ever see in the world, it will be fine. Everything that can be seen in the world can be seen right here. As the lonely notes of the gong rock ring through the afternoon air, all that hear it is invigorated. Succulents fatten their leaves, aloes point their leaves more particularly, and the bat-eared fox family that paused 5 kilometers away find themselves entranced, their ears soaking up the rich fullness of the sound, and in their hearts stir a previously stifled sense of purpose and urgency, and they start making small howls and pawing the ground and jumping up and down. They have missed the gong rock, and now the gong rock is back. The gong rock is back. Back in the car, I rejoin the N1. I coast past Three Sisters and settle in for Richmond and Hanover and Colesberg. The sun is low in the west now and shadows flow across the landscape. The kopjes like dark pools from which in places flaming tufts of grass, twisted firmaments of ancient dried wood, the paused thoughts of slow-moving creatures, century-spanning plants that can name-drop all the way back to the purest of times, of quaffas and bluebuck, trackbokke and beyond even that, rocks that glitter and shimmer like golden motorcycle helmets in a 1970s movie, jump from as if small fish, then dive deep down into the shade as the sun sets another tick, the light cascading off the horizon behind me unchecked, off the coasts of the continent and into unmarked seas upon which it dances, on the smiling snouts of dolphins and the shadow of the car bouncing on its unsure wheels, which seem to want to leave its tentative hold on the surface behind to tiptoe unseen into the air, first a foot then two, then ten, and then high enough to float over oncoming traffic. A startled truck driver points wordlessly to no one, a translux driver too, but to a half-blind old man who can't quite see what he means to be shown, and into the last wash of light, which now breaks lightly onto the shore of the oncoming night here on the footprint and spur-strewn beaches of dusk, where the unused telephone poles, the twigs of the unmade crow's nests, and the limp spaghetti string wires are the flotsam in the ankle-deep waves of thought, as the car joins a small flock of blue crane for a few blissful seconds of perfectly synced slow beat of wing and soft steel-gray aerodynamicism before the illusion shudders and stalls. As the wheel nuts of all four wheels come undone simultaneously, the engine falls from its block and I tumble down to the now purple war zone of a land below, surrounded by different bits of automobile, and I crash land in a trench in the felt just to the left of the road, behind a row of tall agave plants settled here half a century ago to curb soil erosion in those heady years just after the wool boom bust and the Karoo was left with magnificent shearing sheds and farmsteads and kraal complexes and grand entrances to farms with names given to them by the new owners of the land who got the distant descendants of the old owners of the land. Not that anyone ever thought of owning the land back in the heyday of the gong rock, because what is owning? Isn't everything here? Isn't everything that is known held between the tentatively measuring claws of the praying mantis to work for them by a trick of the pen, a quick draw of the line, a deft tumble of coins and brandy? Slowly, I reassemble the car, and with it the parts of my body feeling around in the dark, scrambling in the dusty, oily bloodiness for screws and rivets, nuts and bolts, though sometimes only finding sticks and stones and discarded barbed wire bits and rusted, flattened, burned old tin cans, pieces of bent, corrugated metal sheets, what's left of a long-gone shack maybe, or an itinerant road camp, and shards of bone showing signs of gnawing, handfuls of slippery cartilage and hair, shavings of skin and plump, still warm organ, all mine, all fine, all reassembled and now roaring back up the road, with sparks showering off the back wheels, the night dark and welcoming, a living coat of past and present, simultaneously peeling and wrapping itself, threatening to eat into the future with every hungry beat of the heart. I have lost control. The car and I have been masticated, consumed, crushed, fermented, and scattered out as one indistinguishable mass. Armpit and cubbyhole, femur and indicator paddle, rubber mat and big toe, dashboard and throat. The clawless otter has eaten the crab, crushed the oily sweetmeats from its egg-like shell, and left me, us, this, behind to mark a distant fence post of its endless galaxy of crab pools, shiny springs where nothing but the earliest of mountain reed buck or the latest of robin ever catches even a glimpse of its thick, silky body wriggling along the Kikuyu embankments or disappearing like molten lead in the moonlight held in the meniscus of the pond. Far below, the Free State flickers on. The Garib and Springfontein and Tromsburg and Reddersburg along the highway, and then to the sides, the scattered shovels full of coal, glowing in the brown, wintry night. Philippolis, Forest Smith, Jagersfontein, Betuli, Smithfield, until Bloemfontein blooms bright and cheerful in the distance. Which brings us to the Highveld, which is a shit place to be in winter. It's a big road flanked by roads and towns and cities and smoking chimneys and empty grasslands which are always burned for our pleasure. I'm always in a car, hands stuck in a cubbyhole, fingers in a tape deck, clothes to my seat, dust and smoke, the endless flavor of winter. There's frozen dog shit in the suburbs where the mornings start white and frosty and the afternoons end white and crusty with street lamps and a goalie on Mnet open time. I panic when I can't see the stars. I panic when the sun is a central smog and my direction is a stone pigeon wrapped in a map. There's tea and milk dart from relatives in cages, good people who sigh in their homes and lock their toilets and hide their doormats under their keys in the flat parts of the Free State. The weavers flock aimlessly under dim lights and they build their nests, dangling from concrete silos and steel pylons. Even in the marshes, the reeds bend and break on their own under a heavy low sky, waiting for the slime dam to sweep them into definition. Farming here is an endless wait for December rains, an endless locking of gates to keep the cattle in and the locusts out and the violence in the paper. Little kids buy ice cream and knickknacks from the one stop and their stuffed cheeks full of sharp teeth clatter and glisten and laugh at roadkill. There are places called Florida and Philadelphia and Virginia in the United States, and Montevideo is the capital of Paraguay or Uruguay, so why the fuck do they also exist on the Highveld? The people here are ugly in their cars and pretty in their bars, where hands are for counting money, changing gears and throwing signs and clenching fists, and life here becomes a fiddling for frequencies in between disruptive factories for foreigners and the retracing of daily steps to all brand flakes and uncomfortable sex. You're never on solid ground. There are people everywhere digging out gold and hiding places and finding bad lungs and unexpected sinkholes in bathtubs. People think of murder when they eat in restaurants. They consider rape when they go for a jog while golden retrievers lounge in Northcliff and think of Alaska. The city is littered with untidy people who look at hands on the corners of tables and buildings with the reflection of a cloud framed by a neon triangle. The open felt is rare and littered with derelict pig farms and suitful sunflower fields with only remote aspirations of becoming floro-margarine. The cement is a passive smoker with filters growing on it like disorganized ticks, and the red dust mixes with smoke at sunset to become sentimental gravel. I'm never here because I want to. I'm a co-pilot, a navigator, a shotgun sitter, measuring the miles between two historical sites and toilets for money. If you sit still for long enough, they'll steal your kidneys, and while a friendly nod can kill you, a playful wink can cost you a weekend. If I stay here for too long, I'll become an active abuser, a top-flight loser, a successful gimmick or a professional skunk with labels and a mean piss. Now the Highveld is a shit place to be in winter. We lose altitude and slowly descend, alighting back on the N1 with the touch of barely a feather. And this road, which I now realize could be what tears us apart, and that all to the sides of it lies the black abyss of what once was. That is, if the sun will never rise again. That is, if we are all already dead. That is, if the country of our skull has filled with clear rainwater and is being held aloft atop an outcrop overlooking the confluence of the Limpopo and the Shashi rivers, for that is where the road leads, through the Verkeerevlei Plaza and Kroonval and Grasmere and Pumulani and Hammanskraal and Pinaarsrivier and Kranskop and Capricorn, through the spinning dervishes of Johannesburg, the meted out mundane of Midrand, the ridgetop strongholds of Pretoria, and all the towns that follow, some more broken than others, until nothing remains but a deep, dreamless sleep, from which the questions rise like smoke seen from a distance, leaving a homely chimney like birds. Where am I? What am I?
Filter down through the bottom of the sea.